The gift that keeps on giving. Just when you thought things may be slowing down, last night Russell Westbrook was traded to the Rockets for Chris Paul, reuniting Westbrook with James Harden. Upon hearing the news, NBA players lost it on Twitter. Jamal Crawford, who played with CP3 in LA, tweeted, "Craziest NBA summer by far, and summer just started a few weeks ago. Wow." And former Rocket Patrick Beverley went on to say, "This year about to be lit," with several fire emojis. But the dealing's not over. As our senior NBA insider Adrian Wojnarowski says, no one expects CP3 to stay with OKC.
The market for Chris Paul is going to be small, but Miami's at the top of that list. They'd like to try to get that deal done as soon as they can. And I was told there's some other teams, too, that are going to be discussed. But their hope in getting this deal done with Chris Paul was that he doesn't play a game in a Thunder uniform.
Check this out. Even NFL players weighed in on this. J.J. Watt tweeted, "Gonna miss you, CP3. Not many people know, but CP was literally the first celebrity to reach out and donate to the Hurricane fundraiser. He had just recently been traded to Houston, called up and said he wanted to help. Very first one. Absolute legend." For more, let's get you back to First Take.
All right, a whole lot of reaction as far as that trade is concerned. Lit is one way to describe it. All right, we now bring in host of the Will Cain Show, Will Cain, also NBA analyst Ryan Hollins, to weigh in on this blockbuster deal. Stephen A. is still with us, so.
Charlie, could you hold on? I did not know that I had to do the show this morning with twin brothers. I mean, what the hell is that? Do you see the blue on both of them?
I mean, come on.
I mean, they look like twin brothers. You know what I'm saying?
I didn't know he had flavor, man.
What the hell is he flavor?
I mean, what's going
Stephen
on,
y'all? You can check this out. Yeah. This is more flavor than I've ever come to say. What do you think about that?
You got them TCGs on.
What's on those socks? You got skull and crossbones.
You sitting in max seat, so anything's an upgrade with those shoes on.
Hey, Stephen, we get you a pair of those, dog.
The blue jackets is what I'm talking about. Twin brothers. All right,
and this
go
is
ahead.
Almost like a, it has like a denim look.
I didn't know.
I'm not comfortable. Some say I'm a little more conservative than this. So I'm a little uncomfortable with the style.
Ryan, why don't you just take off the black tie and just stop fighting it, bro? Twin brother.
I told him not to wear a tie.
All right.
We have flavor.
Well, conservative is not something we are looking for right here on the show, especially as it's concerning this trade. Stephen A., are the Rockets better with Westbrook?
I believe they are because I think that he's younger, bigger, stronger, and at this particular juncture in Chris Paul's career, just more lethal, more potent offensively, and obviously able to defend bigger guys. I'm not trying to act like the Houston Rockets are going to win the championship. D'Antoni's still their coach, and I think that's a huge question mark. But their talent, Russell Westbrook with James Harden, despite the fact that both are ball hogs and there are adjustments that clearly need to be made, they get along with one another. They're brothers. Obviously, their talent is undebatable. And then on top of it all, they can't be guarded one on one. Neither one of them. And Russell Westbrook may not be able to have that adroit jump shot that we're looking for, because he shot 29% from 3-point range over the last two seasons, 65% from the free throw line last year, career low. He needs to clean that up. But the flip side to it is he could get to the basket at will. He could finish at the basket better than most, and he certainly can kick it out to a sniper like James Harden, who can do irreparable harm to the opposition. And that, combined with PJ Tucker, Eric Gordon, Clint Capella, makes them incredibly, incredibly potent. I would still make the LA team's favorites over them, but there is no doubt that I think that when you look at the Houston Rockets from a talent perspective, as great as CP3 is as a floor general, because of D'Antoni's system and the way that James Harden was utilized, that's not what you needed as much as you need overall talent. This is the deal that I think that Houston should have made under the circumstances. He's 4 years younger than Chris Paul and obviously has a lot more left physically than Chris Paul does. And I think this was the right move by the Houston Rockets.
Stephen A., let's set aside with the right move for a moment, because I think that's a deeper question about asset management and increasing, as you said, the talent base on your squad. Okay. But the question of whether or not they're better, I hate to be the fly in the ointment here, the guy who's kind of you know, not celebrating at the after party, but I don't know that they are better. In fact, as a basketball team, as from a basketball analysis on the court, I got to think that James Harden and Chris Paul are a better basketball team. And I'm a little astounded, Stephen A., at the way you're waving your hand at some of the most important evidence in this entire thing. I'm perfectly willing to admit, and I listen to you and I listen to Jaylen, they're better on paper, it's better talent, they're more relevant, they have more star power, that Russell Westbrook is a better individual player than Chris Paul at this stage in the game. He's bigger, faster, younger, all the things you laid out, Stephen A. But I also wonder, how the hell does this work with James Harden? How do you put these two together? And I think that's the right basketball analysis when you're asking, are they better? These are two of the highest usage rate players in the NBA. They're two of the highest isolation players in the NBA. And you're going to force one of them off the ball. God help us if it's Russell Westbrook. Because as you just pointed out, and this is what I'm saying, you're waving your hand at this. But this is key. 29% from three for Westbrook. One of the lowest, forget three-pointers for a moment. Mm-hmm. One of the lowest in jump shots, meaning mm-hmm. catch and shoot jump shots in the mm-hmm. NBA. So he can't get into the wood and wait for a pass. And by the way, you think James is going to give away the keys to the kingdom to be the guy who's sitting there waiting for a spot-up shot? I just, man, from a basketball perspective, I don't see how this works.
Well, let me respond to that before Ryan chimes in here. First of all, I think you're ignoring a couple of things. You're looking at their individual talent and their style of play. What you're not looking at is how they could potentially complement one another by taking the pressure off of the other. Remember that when Chris Paul elected to leave the Clippers, one of the biggest reasons he left was because in Clipperland, he had the ball in his hands for every single play. He wanted time off the ball to be that guy that could play the off-guard spot, that could leave point guard responsibility to somebody else.
Do these remind you, do these two guys, Stephen A., honestly remind you of two guys that want less pressure? That's my point. CP3 was ready because he was a floor general to give away. These two are not I would imagine Chris, guys, give
guys,
away.
This is the point that's being missed.
Go ahead.
There's a difference between these two guys of what you can do and what you have to do. So we understand James Harden can go off for 50-point triple-doubles. Russell Westbrook's three straight years averaging a triple-double. That's what they had to do for their teams to have success. And now you're saying that they can't merge, they can't fit together. Here's the reality. Russell Westbrook is a guy who loves the pass, loves to make other guys better, loves to move the basketball. If I'm not mistaken, last year, Paul George had his best year as a professional. So for
that
a guy
is accurate.
Who is deemed as a ball hog, he came in third in MVP voting, and that's a lot of Russell Westbrook. I understand, Will, he shot 29% from three. He needs to fix that. But guess what? When you're out of rhythm and you choose to defer a la Steph Curry and Kevin Durant, things like that happen. And keep in mind, why did James Harden have to go off for 30-point consecutive games? Talk to me.
Hold on. This is what I think, and this is the point I wanted to get to with Will about that. Will, you didn't let me get to it.
Yeah, sorry.
You keep bringing up the players. The coach is there for a reason. When you talk to me about what James Harden won't do, damn it, that's the coach's job.
Thank you.
That's the issue. In other words, and why is that relevant, Will Kane? Because if you recall, after losing a game six, they had no business losing to Golden State without the services of Kevin Durant. A few weeks later, Mike D'Antoni wanted a contract extension. What happened? He ran into a roadblock. What was that roadblock? Although we all surmise that an agreement will eventually be reached, Tillman Fertitta's requirement was, let me give you this $5 million a year. And then after that, give you $1 million per each round that you win in the postseason.
Right.
Why did he try to insert that stipulation in there? Because he wasn't satisfied with the situations. We're looking for some modification from a Mike D'Antoni that says, okay, just pushing the ball up the floor, jacking up threes, not prioritizing defense or what have you, is not good enough. Because if you're going up against a Steve Kerr or if you're going up against a Doc Rivers, you're going to have to make adjustments. And so as a result of that, when we look at James Harden and we look at Russell Westbrook, what I would say to you is my concern is not the players. My concern is the coaching.
Stephen A., when in history, I can think of one example, okay? One example of two high usage players, players that are alphas who want to take over, came together and were better for it. Because what I'm asking you is, are you giving Mike D'Antoni an impossible task here of figuring out two guys that are not just similar, but extreme? I'm talking about extreme usage, extreme alphas. The only example I can come up with, Stephen A., is KD and Steph. It's two guys that ran the show, and they came together, and this is one of the reasons those two players are so special, because they were willing to defer as individuals. I would say there's no evidence. Ryan can talk about whether or not they will. There's zero evidence that these two will defer.
Let me ask you your question. Certainly, when you talk about usage, you can make that point. But I'm thinking personalities, because that's where it comes from. I'm not thinking about what you literally see on the court. I'm talking about the mentality behind it. I recall watching Larry Brown in Detroit. He had Rasheed Wallace, Bennett Wallace, okay, Rip Hamilton, who was no joke, had a very strong-willed personality. Chauncey Billups, there were questions about him until he showed us the leader that he obviously was. I'm simply saying that there have been a plethora of situations.
I can't let you do that,
Pat
Stephen
Riley,
A.
There's been others where you look at certain situations, and Ryan could come up with other examples. I'm only making the point about coaching, Will.
I can't let you do that to D'Antoni, and I understand he's not a championship coach. We hadn't seen it from him before, but here's the reality. This is a team that had personnel problems, and we all kept looking back at Trevor Ariza and said that was a huge loss. They didn't have a secondary playmaker. So you say, why does James Harden play so much one-on-one? Chris Paul could not create his own shot. In fact, he needed Clint Capella.
He needed
those guys to help.
Stop right there, Ryan. Stop right there. I recall watching Eric Gordon flat-out ball. And then they forgot to get him the damn ball in games 5 and 6. Come on now.
But is Eric Gordon a playmaker, Stephen A.?
Time out. Listen to what I'm saying, former player. You understand that when somebody has the hot hand, get them the damn ball, feed the beast. You don't ignore him.
The coach has
to make sure that something like that. I'm not saying that D'Antoni can't coach. I'm not saying he's not a good coach. I'm saying that
he does have to figure it out, Stephen A. But what I'm telling you is there's been no coach that I can think of in history who's been tasked with this level of trying to make two pieces that do not fit together fit. Please, for a second. Please, with the Detroit Pistons from 2004. That is not Russ and James Harden. Paul George is not James Harden. Talking about the way Paul George played with Russell Westbrook is not the same thing as James Harden. What I'm telling you is these two are so extreme, so similar, that I don't know that D'Antoni can figure it out.
You guys are missing
the point. And Chris Paul, at least, one last point, Ryan. Stephen A., I hear you on the personality. I truly do. If they like each other, that's going to go a long way. And obviously, CP3 and James Harden had some problems. But